Hi everyone. In this session, we are going to discuss about what is derivative controller and how it will improve the closed loop system performance. Right. So from the past few videos, I have been explaining the same example. So even in this video also, I will proceed with the same example so that it will become very easy to you. My sincere advice to all of you is, before proceeding to the further section, you please watch the previous 2-3 videos so that the discussion will be very clear to you. Otherwise, you will not understand how I am using the variables. So please watch the previous 2-3 videos and then continue. Now let us see how the derivative controller will going to act in the closed loop control system. Before going to that, let us consider the same block diagram which we are using from the past 2-3 videos. And here we are having the set point, that is, we require the amount of deviation in the set point is equal to 4 into u of t. This is the expectation set point. And we also know that the transmitter will going to convert the deviation in the water level into a deviation into the current. Now the error is going to be the difference between these two, and the controller comes into the picture. And here the function of the controller is going to be derivative in nature, means it will perform the differentiation. A device which performs the differentiation is actually called the derivative controller. In simple words, of course, we require a lot of mechanism to prepare the derivative controller, but I have explained you the simple words. Now, this controller, based on the amount of error, it will be able to generate some current, and that current will flow through the actuator. So I told you that it is electrically operated valve. So actuator converts this into water flow. That means it will going to change the fluid flow rate. And when the fluid flow rate is changed, then the water level will going to change. And I have been explaining from the past 3 videos, that is, this liquid level process is a first order system. And ultimately, the water level in the tank should be reached to the desired value. Now, let me quickly say what are the variables we used here. The HS of T is nothing but the water level, the desired water level with respect to time. That is equal to HS cap of T plus HS of 0 minus. 0 minus means initial condition. Right? So initial value of the water before we change the set point is equal to 0.5 meter. So altogether, this is a deviation in the set point. How much is the deviation? 4 into U of T. Right? Sorry, this is IS of T. So HS of T deviation is 0.5 into U of T. Nice. So IS of T can be written as IS cap of T plus IS of 0 minus. That means whatever the water level we have given, that will be taken by the control loop as current. So corresponding to HS cap of T, we have IS cap of T, that is deviation in the current, which is nothing but 4 into U of T. And here IS of 0 minus means before we change the set point, the initial current of the set point, that is 8 milliampere. Now corresponds to that, we are going to have HM of T, that is water level in the tank at any point of time. That will be again deviation plus initial water level. So again, corresponds to that, we are going to have IM of T. Now this set is clear. When it comes to IC of T, that is controller current, we all know that controller current also deviates. That means change in current, IC cap of T plus IC of 0 minus. That means before we change the set point, initially, the value of the current generated by the controller is 12 milliampere. This is called controller bias. I have been explaining the same point from the last 3 videos. Right? So now, the relation between the water level and the current is given by H of T is equal to 1 by 8 into I of T minus 4 milliampere. So this is the equation we get from the linear operation of the transmitter. Right? So please watch the previous 2 videos, it will be clear to you. Now, good thing about this is, when it comes to the error with respect to time, error can be denoted in terms of the water level, or error can be denoted in terms of the current. Now, in terms of water level means it will become HS of T minus HM of T. And where HS of T, if you keep substitute all these things, then we are going to get E cap of T. That is, deviation in the error is equal to HS cap of T minus HM cap of T. Or else, if you write in terms of current, then it will going to become E cap of T is equal to IS cap of T minus IM cap of T. That is, E cap of T error is equal to IS cap of T minus IM cap of T. Clear? Now, the relation between H of T and I of T is going to be this one. And the deviation between the H of T, deviation of water level and deviation of current will be this one. Clear? So, I have explained all the variables, whatever we are going to use in the next discussion. Because without understanding the variables, you will not be able to understand how a derivative controller really acts in the closed loop control system. Now, let me tell you one more point here. If you look at here, qa of d cap is going to be k dash into ic cap of d. Now, purposefully I have taken, for the mathematical convenience I have taken, k dash is equal to 1. Then qi cap of t will be equal to 1 into ic cap of t. That is directly I have written here. Now let us take the equation. Let's go deeply into the operation. If you consider this first order process, first thing we can write down dhm cap of t plus dt plus hm cap of t is equal to qi cap of t. What is this qi cap of t? Qi cap of t, that is flow rate, deviation in the flow rate, equal to 1 into ic cap of t. That's what I have written here. And this ic cap of t is a function of error cap of t. That means this, there will be some function here, that function of e cap of t. What is e cap of t? Now let's investigate what is error in this process. Error is also a variable which varies with respect to time. That can be written as e cap of t plus e of 0 minus. E of 0 minus is nothing but the error initially, before changing the set point. What is the error? So that time we don't have the error because it is at steady state, right? So error is 0 at that time. So e of t is equal to e cap of t. That means in the entire evaluation, there is no difference even if you write like e cap of t or e of t. Now, if I substitute this, let us look at what is going to happen here. So this is same here, same here. Now, as I said, this function is going to be now derivative in nature, correct? So derivative controller means the current generated by the deviation in the current generated by the controller will be equal to kd into d by d of e cap of t. Now e cap of t can be written from here as hs cap of t minus hm cap of t. Now if you still go ahead in terms of currents, then how it will going to change? Because already I have mentioned of everything. So this one can be written here as hm cap of t is equals to 1 by 8 into im cap of t. Now if I substitute all these things here, then finally with a small little bit mathematical arrangements, we will be able to get up to here, right? Now this differential equation we should use to understand how the water level changes with respect to time. Now let's investigate how it should be. Now let's consider the differential equation what we got here, that is 1 plus kd into d im cap of t by dt plus im cap of t is equal to 4 kd d by dt u of t. Now to solve this further, I sincerely advise it is better to apply the Laplace transform so that our analysis will be completed as early as possible. Our analysis will be completed very fast. Now let's apply Laplace transform here. If you apply Laplace transform on both sides, apply Laplace transform, LT means Laplace transform on both sides. Let's see what will going to happen here. So 1 plus kd whole into s into im of s, anyway initial value of this cap, im cap of t is equal to 0, so initial value is not required. Now plus this will going to be equals to im cap of s, and here this will be equals to 4 into kd d by dt, that is s into u of s. U of s is equal to 1 by s, so in fact it will become like this. So this will go off, right? So from here we can even rewrite like this, that is im cap of s if you take outside, then inside the bracket you will going to have 1 plus s into 1 plus kd whole equals to 4 times of kd. This from here we can still write down im cap of s is equals to 4 times of kd, right, by 1 plus kd whole into 1 by s plus 1 by 1 plus kd. Clear? This is what you are going to get if you take this factor here and after taking the commons, right? Now im cap of t from here, how can we write? Im cap of t is going to be equals to 4 times of kd by 1 plus kd into e power minus of 1 by 1 plus kd into t into u of t, anyway t greater than 0, it will be equal to 1. This is the variable of im, which it changes with respect to the time, im cap with respect to time. If this is im cap of t, how will be the water level deviation? That is, we already know from past few videos, I am saying the same point. That is, hm cap of t is equal to 1 by 8 times im cap of t, right? So this will going to be equals to 1 by 8 means it is going to be a 0.5 times of kd by 1 plus kd whole into e power minus of 1 plus kd, that is 1 by whole into t, right? This is hm cap of t, but it is not the hm of t. How we get hm of t? That we know, hm of t can be written as hm cap of t plus hm 0 minus initial water level. So hm of t altogether from here can be written as hm cap of t is this one plus, so this is 0.5 times of kd by 1 plus k times of d e power minus of 1 by 1 plus kd whole into t, plus hm of 0 minus is going to be 0.5 meter. All together it should be in meters. This is the way how the water level will going to change if you use a derivative controller, right? Now we will see with respect to time what happens here. Time and water level hm of t. Now when we substitute t is equal to 0 here, that means t 0 seconds, let's see what will going to happen. Starting, right? Hm of t, substitute t is equal to 0 here, it will become e power 0, 1, right? So 0.5 kd plus 1 plus kd. In fact, it could be better if you see just before 0 second, that means before we change the set point, that is 0 minus second, then it could be equal to hm of 0 minus. I am sure that it will be equal to 0.5 meter. Everybody in the attending from the past 3 videos, you can understand this, right? So now, if I substitute at 0 seconds, maybe 0 plus seconds, sudden change will be able to, you can see a sudden change, that is just 0 if you substitute, what will going to happen? It will going to be equal to 0.5 kd by 1 plus kd plus 0.5 meter, right? This is what the water level will be. Right, so let me write down here 0.5 meter. So that means for a small minute change, derivative controller aggressively reacts and keeps the water level at this point. Right, now if I take here at infinite seconds, let us see what will going to happen. Right, at infinite seconds, if you look at infinite seconds, if you keep infinite here, irrespective of kd, this factor will be 0, overall it will be 0, you will be left with 0.5 meter. Right, so it will be equal to 0.5 meter. Clear? So that means if you wait for long time, that is for steady state, infinite seconds, we will say this as a steady state. If you wait for such a long time, the water level will be equals to 0.5 meter. For how much it should be equal? It should be actually equals to 1 meter. So in fact, if you look at whatever the initial value of the water level we are having, again we came back to the same value. Right? So that means the rectification was not done properly, you are not able to reach the required value, right? So in fact, if you try to evaluate here the error, so you are going to get a lot of error here, right? Because we need to get 1 meter, unfortunately we got only 0.5 meter as the value of the water level, right? So now, if you see the graph will be really very interesting, that is, give you 1 minute time. So if you look at the graph, it looks like this. That is with respect to time, right? And here we have hm of t. And initially, that is before t is equal to 0, the water level is 0.5 meter here. Now exactly at t is equal to 0 seconds, very minute time, you will be able to see 0.5 kd plus 1 plus kd, divided by 1 plus kd plus 0.5. So there will be a sudden rise, actually, very sharp rise in the water level, right? So this value is going to be 0.5 kd by 1 plus kd plus 0.5 meters. This is the value. Now the crazy thing here is, it changes very fast, rapid response will be there. And this rapid response will be there. After that, if you look at it, exponentially, it will going to decrease. And finally, it will going to become again 0.5 meter. Again, it will going to come back to the same value. Right? So, unfortunate this is, because we want the water level should be really at 1 meter. We want the water level should be at 1 meter. Right? So now it comes to the game of KD here. Right? Suppose if you take KD is equal to 1, KD is equal to 1, what will going to happen? 0.5 by 2, that is 0.25 plus 0.5, this peak value will be 0.75. Right? Suppose if KD is equal to 2, then it will become 1 by 1 plus 2. So little bit higher value. Right? So that means if you are increasing the value of KD, this peak will slowly come here. It will slowly increase. But what you need to understand is, derivative controller acts like a catalyzer. It will boost the response very fast. Right? But unfortunately, for the first order systems, we cannot expect the steady state error is equal to 0. So this means it is aggressive in nature, and the first thing is, the speed of response is increased. Speed of response, very fast we are actually getting the spike initially. It is reacting very fast. Right? That's why as it is reacting very fast and it is anticipated in the future, it is actually called an anticipatory controller. Speed of response is quick, that means it is reacting fast. Right? And the drawback here is, what we need to remember at this point of time is, steady state error, that is for lower order systems, for example, first order systems, steady state error, SSC, steady state error can't be equal to 0%. Okay, so that means we are not able to reach the desired qualifications here, desired response, because we ultimately want the steady state error should be equal to 0% and the speed of response should be high. So the derivative controller, as it is a catalyzer, it is reacting very fast, but unfortunately we are not getting the 0% steady state error. So this is the problem if you use derivative controller alone for first order systems. So by this time you might understood that if you use the derivative controller, simple derivative controller, or even for the PD controller for a first order system in closed loop control configuration, you may not end up with the zero steady state error, but the response may be quick enough, right? So now we will see what is the advantage of PD controller, proportional derivative controller, if we use it for the higher order system. Let's discuss in the frequency domain approach so that you will see the other phase of the same discussion. That is, we all know that the loop gain here can be written as GC of S into H of S. This is going to be called as open loop transfer function of the closed loop system. Let me write down. Open loop transfer function of closed loop system equals to G of S into H of S. This is open loop transfer function of closed loop system equals to, in simple words, it is going to be G of S is now GC of S into GP of S into GA of S into H of S. Now let's investigate one by one here. So what is GC of S? We are using the proportional plus derivative controller together, right? So then GC of S can be given as KP into 1 plus tau D into S. This is going to be the transfer function of the PD controller. Okay, so KP into tau D can be given as KD, what we have discussed earlier. Okay, so KP into 1 plus tau D into S, GP of S, in fact GA of S, we know that it could be 1 because we have taken it grantedly for actuator transfer function is 1, but from the starting onwards for the mathematical convenience. Now G of s is 1 and G P of s. Now the game comes here with the G P of s. So let me say G P of s, that is a process as a second order transfer function, that is 1 by s into s plus 1. Okay, 1 by 1 into s into s plus 1. And H of s, let's consider this feedback as unity feedback, so it is going to be 1 here. Clear? After this much, we got open loop transfer function of closed loop system completely. Clear? Because I have substituted this one. Now, intentionally, we will do one thing. We will take this value and this value. For let us assume that Kp has taken like 1, right? And here tau d, let me take tau d as 0.1. Okay, so then open loop transfer function will going to become like 1 into, or else you can take 2 if you want, Kp is equal to 2. Because anyway, the Kp and tau d, all these things will depend on the controller tuning method. So this is going to be 2 here. So it will be equal to 2 into 1 plus 0.1 into s by s into s plus. Okay, for understanding purpose, let us don't take Kp value, let's keep Kp as Kp itself, but let's consider tau d is equal to 0.1, that is derivative time constant is equal to 0.1. Now interesting fact here is, we will be able to get here as Kp into this much, right? So let us consider 0.1, take outside this 0.1. If you take outside 0.1, so it will be equal to 0.1 times of Kp, right? So into 1 plus, this is going to be s plus 10 divided by s into s plus 1, right? So this is the open loop transfer function. In fact, with the derivative controller, with PD controller. Because I already told you that PD controller transfer function is going to be this much. Okay. So now let us see how the root locus looks like this for this. So the root locus plot for this, in a simple words, root locus. I am not sketching the original root locus. For understanding purpose, I am giving the root locus here. So open loop transfer function poles. We know that here the poles, one pole is at s is equal to 0. Another pole is at s is equal to minus 1. What does it mean? It means that one pole is at origin 0 and another pole is at minus 1, right? So the 0, which is added by the proportional and derivative controller, PD controller, 0, because 0 is minus 10, so it will be at here, minus 10, right? So this is going to be 0 here. This is 0. Now look at this. What happens for the root locus? If you look at this total root locus plot here, S plane, now we know that this closed loop pole will travel like this. If you increase the value of controller gain, this will come like this somewhere, and this will going to come like this, right? And both will going to meet at a break point, and then from here, and I am damn sure that it will try to trace to the open loop 0. Now 0 is at minus 10, so this means that the closed loop pole trace will come like this, and this might be somewhere here, and here we are going to have breaking point, and this root locus all the way it will travel in this locus, and it will going to come and again meet at break point, and then one branch will going to terminate here, other branch will go for minus infinity. Clear? This is the way how the root locus looks like. So the great thing or great achievement here is, irrespective of the value of Kp or controller gain, the root locus is always left side of the j omega axis. So what does it mean? What is the significance of this? This means that the closed loop system is stable. Clear? So that means PD controller is actually providing damping, such that it can improve the stability of the higher order systems. Because second order system. But in the case of first order system, we understood that there is some concern with the steady state error. But when we use for the second order system, we will be able to get a beautiful response like this, and the closed loop system may be stable. Now we will see, suppose if you don't use the PD controller, what will happen?
suppose if you don't use the PD controller, then obviously you should not have this one, right? So let us say we have only using the proportional controller. So at that situation, this could be written as proportional controller means only KP, right? So then tau d will not be there, and open loop transfer function looks like this now. So this is with PD controller. Remember this one, figure 1. Let me write down this one as figure 1. Figure 1 is by using the PD controller. Now, if you don't use a PD controller, if you use only proportional controller, GC of S will be KP into 1 by S into S plus 1 into 1, because the feedback is 1. Right? Now, open loop transfer function here, it looks like KP by S into S plus 1. Right? S into S plus 1. Now, have you seen here, if you draw the root locus for this, how the root locus will be? We all know that this S into S plus 1 can be written as one pole at origin and another pole at minus 1, and there will be no 0 at all, right? If there is no 0, then the root locus will going to be like this. It will travel in this way and this pole will travel in this way, and now if you look at, I can say this is how the root locus diagram looks like, correct? This is how it will be. So what does it mean? In fact, this root locus is almost near to the j omega axis. If it is near to the j omega axis, I can say, even though it is a stable system, this is much more stable system. Clear? Because the root locus is actually traveling in the negative side of the S-plane. But here, it is almost near to the j omega axis. Clear? So that means if something happens, there is a chance that, of course, I can say that both are stable only, but relatively the stability is more here because of the proportional plus derivative controller, which actually provides the damping. Now let's just say, let's see the same story in the different way. Suppose let us consider GP of S instead of this, which we consider as 1 by S into S plus 1. Take it as S square. Okay. So second order system, but the poles are at origin. Then how it looks like? If you don't use a PD controller, if you use only P proportional controller, then I am sure that root locus will be like this. That is, this is going to be now S square only. Root locus, how it will be? Because if I say this is J omega axis, we have double pole at origin now in open loop transfer function. So two poles are there here. Right? Now, if you increase the KP value, the closed loop system poles will travel like this, right? From here, this itself will going to become breakpoint. From here, it will go in this way. So what does it mean? It cannot even tolerate for a small KP values, right? So once the KP is greater than 0, then the closed loop system poles will travel like this, and the system will become unstable even for KP greater than 0. That means if KP is simply greater than 0, then the closed loop system, becomes unstable. Clear? But if you use PD controller, what is going to happen? PD controller means I should write this one as now KP into 1 plus 0.1 S. Let me consider tau d is equal to 1. Then I am sure that if you take this 0.1 outside, then it will going to become here as S, and this will become 10, or else I can say S plus 10 here into 0.1 outside. Clear? So this is the things you are going to get if you use a PD controller. Now all together with PD controller, how it looks like this. With PD controller, try to understand clearly. If you are not getting it, watch two times, then you will be able to find the difference here clearly. So now the interesting fact is, when we use PD controller here, the overall open loop transfer function looks like this. That is 0.1 times of KP into S plus 10 whole divided by S square. Now let us see how the root locus looks like for this. So S plus 10, 0 is here. We have 0 at minus 10, and there were two poles of open loop transfer function at origin. And anyway, this is j omega axis. Now look at the beauty of this one. Now, what happens here is, when we increase the value of Kp now, the closed loop system poles will travel like this. That means they will be coming like this. The root locus will be like this now. So this is going to end at this open loop 0, and another pole will go to minus infinity this side. So what does it mean? This means that when we use PD controller, closed loop system poles are always on the left hand side or in the left hand side of J omega axis. Clear? So that means this is absolutely stable system. Right? But here it is not at all stable system. That means the closed loop system in this case, closed loop system is a stable. So, conclusion is, if you use a PD controller, as it provides additional zero, there is a chance to shift the entire root locus. Clear? So, as it is providing some kind of damping here, we can protect the stability of the system. So, let me conclude the entire PD controller once. Proportional plus derivative controller, if we use it for higher order system, derivative mechanism will provide the damping and proportional controller will boost the speed and the steady state error. Okay, for higher order systems. But if you use a PD controller for the lower order systems like first order system, we can't guarantee whether steady state error becomes zero or not.
Hope you enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching. And if you want to find more of this kind of questions, connect to my channel. Namaste.